brighten up those already bright mornings. Wheeler, Ollie, and Lekter. Mornings at the Cabin.
Mornings at the Cabin, indeed. Wheeler and Lekter with you on your Thursday morning. It's Team Burger Thursdays here at Mornings at the Cabin. Not officially sponsored by A&W, but hey, we'll still get those Team Burgers.
We can dream, can't we?
We can dream at some point. We'll go in there and be like, and they'll be like, you know, if we keep shopping there, at some point they'll be like, hey, do you want us to sponsor the show?
Yeah.
And we'll be like, yes, we do. Every Thursday from now until eternity.
We just do everything they would want us to do for free. They're bound to respect us.
That's right. That's right. This is how capitalism works. You do things for free, eventually somebody will pay you for it.
It's called an internship.
Yeah, unpaid. Well, not unpaid. We pay for them with Dean Burgers.
We're not good at capitalism.
No one really is. It's a crisp morning, and if we duck into fall, we reach the end of a really quiet fire season, which means there were very few gender reveal parties in the north this summer. Good Lord, have you seen the footage out of California?
I haven't seen the footage. I've seen the pictures and I've seen the headlines.
So the wildfires, obviously, wildfires are a huge problem in the western part of the U.S. Huge problem in Oregon, huge problem in California.
For like the last 5 years.
For like the last forever.
Just
wildfires have been a huge problem there forever.
Yeah.
But obviously these latest ones, a few of them tied to a gender reveal party in California. Yeah. And
it's explosive news.
It's explosive news indeed. But weird-ass people just can't get enough of these gender... Who cares?
Butt people are the weirdest.
Let alone you're putting something on your kid that may not be true.
That's true.
Yeah. The other part of it is, who cares?
Yeah, I don't understand why they're such a big thing.
I don't understand it either. Yeah. But hey, I'm not a parent, and I'll probably lose my mind when I have a kid, too.
Mornings at the Cabin, the podcast.
Here we are on Thursday morning, and I did, on Friday... Our, former interns, now full-time reporters, Sarah Sibley and Meaghan Brackenbury, took over the waves on Friday afternoon, had a little music trivia.
They did.
Now, you wanted to talk about this yesterday, but then I was like, you know what, bros? I'm not coming in today as an act of rebellion.
It really messed everything up.
No, fair enough. I'm sure you guys had a great show. Didn't listen.
No, we had nothing planned.
Oh, okay. Well, no, that's usually how we do the show, though. Yeah.
Well, we meandered into like four different topics per break rather than just, you know, two or three.
Okay.
Yeah.
And did anyone get on the mic and go, well, apparently we've run out of things to talk about constantly? Several times? Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. As long as it's happening when I'm also not here, great.
AJ actually dipped into that kind of
AJ can
nonsense.
Stuff it. AJ can stuff.
Yeah. Ollie threw it out. Yeah. I just said right off the bat, I was like, I got nothing planned. I had a whole show planned for today.
Yeah.
But it hinged on Jesse being here.
Oh, fair enough.
He's not here, so I got nothing.
I feel like we could make a t-shirt for Ollie that says, so we've just run out of things to talk about. Mornings at the Cabin.
Well, we were going to get into those catchphrases, right?
That's right. I mean, that's a good catchphrase for him.
Dot, dot, dot. So we've run out of things to talk about.
Yeah. And mine is, why not Yellowknife? Or, well, I've already got mine.
Yeah, you already got yours.
This Evan Town.
Yeah.
I got to make that other one. I got the PK fan club.
That's another thing you missed yesterday.
Unky Lawrence Playhouse.
You missed your fan club guy. I don't know how to phrase that.
You don't know how to phrase
PK was here
that.
Yesterday.
What?
Yeah.
What was he doing here?
He was talking about Far North Photo Festival.
When did that happen? Why wasn't I told about this? I've never told about the guests.
So I had a thought that maybe this was partially the reason that you didn't come in. I wasn't
sure. I was just going to be too starstruck.
Well,
I can't control myself around Pat Kane.
No, so I mean, we knew that would be a very exciting thing for you. You are the self-appointed president of the PK fan club.
All the questions would have been like, so Pat, anyway, I mean, like, how's photos? And he would just like turn... from me to you and go,
so anyway,
just be crestfallen.
So AJ had set it up that they were going to come in and talk about it, but he wanted to surprise you because, you know, it'd be a very exciting thing, obviously. So we put it in the calendar.
Why I hate surprises.
That's what I kind of maybe thought it. So we put it in the calendar as like a mystery guest was coming in.
I didn't see that in the calendar at all.
Oh, okay. Well,
I didn't. Usually I get an update. When the calendar gets updated, I'll get an email saying calendar been updated. And now normally I completely ignore those. But let's just see. It just says guest mystery. Yeah, don't do that. Some cool festival or something. Don't do that. I'm not going to. respond to that.
See, that was exactly what we thought. We originally, he put that in there. We were like, yeah, we'll surprise him. It'll be fun. And then yesterday, or rather Tuesday night when you sent the message saying that you were going to take the morning off, I was thinking about it later and came in. I was like, yeah, he might have actually seen that, seen surprise guests and just being like, no, not going to do that.
No, I didn't see it. No. I mean, had I seen it? Had I seen that update? Again, usually I get an email with these things. I seen it, I would have just messaged and been like, who's the guest? Don't do this.
Who wouldn't have told you?
Well, then I would have been like, well, I guess I'm not coming in.
That's exactly what I thought may have happened.
Did not see that. Okay. Would have relished the opportunity to sit down with Pat Gane and talk a little Far North Film Fest, or Florida Fest, pardon me. And I missed it.
So we'll have to wait for another day.
Two ships passing in the night.
Me and PK all over. That's right.
Anyway, back to the thing we started talking about.
So let's
Sibs
do.
Are we going with Sibs and Bracks or Bracks and Sibs?
Brack and Sibs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
It just works now.
I like it. Yeah.
Got to hit it harder with the Brack.
Brack and Sibs.
Brack and Sibs.
Brack and Sibs.
So this past Friday, yes, they took over Shannon's show. She took a couple days vacation. And
that's Shannon. Always taking time off. Broken back. Other things. Just.
Yeah, you know. Some people are so entitled. Right?
I know.
So she took a couple days and Brack and Sibs stepped in and wanted to do something a little bit different. They played a couple games. They played, I think a kind of music trivia game on Thursday. But then on Friday, they came to you and I after our show and said, we want to mix it up because we made it too easy on ourselves.
That's right.
Give us three songs. So I wrote down three songs and you wrote down three songs. Mm-hmm. And then they were going to play clips of those songs for each other. And quiz
to see if they knew
whether or not they knew them.
Okay.
So it's supposed to be obviously like pretty, you know, pretty well-known songs.
Yeah, I didn't put well-known songs.
You didn't. And I wanted to admonish you a little
bit. Okay, admonish. Oh, no.
We're trying to play a fun game.
Are
Jesse.
We? No, they, see, I gave them songs that people know. It's just that like maybe 21-year-olds.
You gave them one song that people know.
What was it? I can't even remember, honestly. I can't even remember what songs I came up with.
The third song was a good selection. That's a song that people know. It's a 90s staple. Okay. It was No Diggity.
No Diggity, No Doubt.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
The second song you picked was a White Stripes song.
Of course.
White Stripes, well-known band.
Absolutely.
A song that I've never heard of.
What was it?
I don't know.
What was it called?
I have no idea.
What do you mean?
It was a song I've never heard of.
Oh, too bad.
Like... Pick Seven Nation Army.
Oh, Apple Blossom. Yeah, Apple Blossom. It's one of their most well-known songs.
No one's heard of that song.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Nobody knows
that song. It is absolutely one of their classic songs.
You play it this morning, and I bet it'll be the first time most people have ever heard it. And
then I thought it was supposed to be a challenge. I didn't know I was supposed to be like, We Will Rock You by Queen. I'm sure nobody will get that.
That might have been a good one for them. That's not in their,
they
it's not their wheelhouse.
Up. Go ahead.
So the point of the game, though, is that it has to be achievable.
Oh, I see.
It has to be a challenge.
Oh, see, no.
But achieve. You know, if Trivial Pursuit was just whacked out stuff that nobody knows, nobody would play the game.
Well, if you played Genus One right now, you would think that.
I would never play Genus One.
It was for the Greatest Generation, Genus One.
Oh, I thought you said Genius One.
No, Genus.
Okay, well,
Genus means just general knowledge.
I have no business in either of those.
No, you don't. well, general knowledge you do.
But that was a garbage selection.
Okay, fair enough.
But your first selection was the most garbage.
Most garbage? What was it?
You picked a largely unknown song by a hipster band.
What was it?
That I think appeared on like Late Night once. You
I can't remember what it is.
Saw them. You were like, this band's amazing.
Yeah, yeah, Future Islands.
Yeah, nobody knows.
Everybody
Future
knows
Islands.
Future Islands.
Nobody knows.
They're an incredibly
Islands
popular
is.
Band.
There's like a
We play them. They are in heavy rotation.
They
on,
are.
Yeah.
They are, but they're not a household name.
They're fantastic.
That's fine.
They
Be
played
that
Glastonbury. They've played David Letterman Show, which obviously Brax and Sibs would know. Brax and Sibs.
Kids their age are
they're
definitely
all over
watching
Letterman.
Late night television.
He's been off the air for 5 years. When they were 16, they were all over.
I'm very happy for Future Islands and their career that is building and blossoming. But nobody knows who Future Islands is.
Okay, we've been talking about this too long. We're going to have to come back to it.
Well, I wanted to set it up because
they
actually admonish you.
Oh, good.
In their own thing.
Oh, good. Okay, well, let's come back to it. Let's get to the news.
Okay.
And then we'll come back to it.
All right.
Brack and Sibs and their wonderful mystery music game. That I totally screwed up.
The Mornings at the Cabin podcast. Hey, it was early. What do you want from us?
Don't forget, With the City of Yellowknife, hosting a drive-in movie on September 18th. Also a double feature on October 2nd. Go to Mortars at the Cabin Facebook page to comment and pick from the list of movies. I haven't checked in a couple days, so I don't know what's in the lead, but I mean, like, Back to the Future is actually playing at the theater this week, coming up this week.
Do you want to know who's in the lead?
Sure.
Back to the Future.
Well, people can get their Back to the Future taste this week.
Only so many, though.
That's true. That's true. Okay, well, there it is.
It's ahead 21-16. Hook is in second place.
Hook.
Yeah.
I can get behind that.
Man, Groundhog Day is still getting zero love.
I don't have
two votes.
It's weird that that's like considered one of the greatest comedies of all time and at the same time is underrated.
It's not a drive-in movie.
It's not a drive-in movie. You're right. It is. You're absolutely right.
Great movie, but yeah, not really a big screen.
Mighty Ducks, on the other hand. Let's see Jesse Smollett in big screen. We were talking about Brack and Sibs.
And
this past Friday, their music trivia show, which I completely derailed with my excellent music choices. But you wanted to play a couple of clips.
So let's get right into it. Here is them introducing their show this past Friday.
Perfect.
So Meg and I we had a lot of fun yesterday playing the Guess That song.
We did.
But it was really too easy, the songs that we picked for each other. So we had Jesse and Lekter kind of choose some songs for us to pose against each other. I have changed two of Jesse's choices.
What? See, they said it was too easy.
No,
this is why
anybody would know them.
Oh my god.
Sorry, Jesse.
Oh, whatever. Jesse, whatever.
Your music taste is just not hip with us youth.
Or is it too hip?
Too hip.
Yeah. All right, so that was, wanted to throw that in there because that was them throwing a little bit of early shade at you.
Yep.
And here was the start of, I believe this was Meaghan choosing, Sarah playing songs for Meaghan and her trying to pick them.
Get Are you ready for the first one?
I am ready. Let it rip.
This is a song that I am personally a really big fan of.
So this is one of the ones she changed.
Hopefully it's good, and it's not really in Meaghan's genres. So we'll see what goes.
Well, see, I'd be interested if you know this one. Apparently it was really big.
Just wait. It's so good.
I have.
Are you Pandora-ing this right now?
What?
Does that voice sound familiar to you at all?
Okay, that's why I don't know it.
Yeah. Is this country?
Okay. I have no idea.
This was a bigger country song, though.
You didn't even try to use stuff that I might know.
I don't know.
Don't know what it
is. Big one, though.
Yeah. She'll get it, too.
But I don't know. I purposely don't pay attention to
I had no idea
country.
Who it was either.
Country?
Okay,
how's this country?
Ready? Here we go.
Well, the artists are how it's country.
Who is that?
I don't know.
No.
Yeah. I don't like
that. Not a clue. No.
Who is that?
It's Carrie Underwood.
Ew.
Okay.
Do you have any guesses about who the leading man is?
I could just like throw out
one of the
country
Jonas
names.
Do it.
Joel Plaskett.
No.
I don't know. He's one of the biggest ones out there.
Tim McGraw?
No. Keith Urban.
Oh.
There you go. Yeah, I had no clue on that one either. Apparently it was a big hit. I don't know. I remember Carrie Underwood and Keith Urban, doing some stuff together, but I mean, not my wheelhouse, so.
Keith Urban's a Chaz Wesser.
I call him a bullfrog, but all right.
That's just you.
And so here was their next song. Next one after Meaghan Crash and Burned.
And then so this is one that she changed of mine again?
This is another one that she changed of yours.
Yeah,
this
I'm so glad
one,
I got to participate.
I have told Meaghan if she doesn't get it right, we can't be friends anymore.
Which is stressful, but
this,
yes.
This band coming up. Actually, I'm not even going to say anything because it's going to give it away. But I'll just say this was one of the first CDs I ever owned.
That'll make you feel old real quick.
Here we go.
Testing.
Boo! Oh my god.
Yes, at least terrible. You have the band right, thank goodness.
And you would have got that. I know you would have got the band.
Yeah,
Did you know the song title?
I can't remember the song title.
You haven't had enough.
Mariana's Trench?
Yeah.
That's close enough. Yeah. It's
haven't had enough.
Yeah.
I just wanted to skip to the end here because,
that's like our eight.
So apparently Sarah Sibley was a huge Mariana's Trench fan.
Yeah.
Ever after.
Of course.
I forgot that you were a huge fan of the Trench.
I'll give it to the lead.
Wait.
Yeah,
Trench wench.
Again.
Yeah. Trench wench.
Ew.
That's what they call themselves.
Ew.
I have no idea. Ew, ew. How disgusting is all of that?
All right. Marietta's Trench.
And here was the third and final song
that I actually got to pick.
For Brax, that you actually picked.
Perfect.
Great pick.
So,
here we go.
Meg's sitting at, I would say, a good 1.5 points. is that fair?
That's being nice.
I got, generous.
I got you.
Two?
Yeah,
come
two.
On.
Okay.
Give me my
due
frog.
Yeah. Meg's sitting at 2 points. This last one here is Jesse's song.
Okay.
This
Do you
song,
think I'll get this?
You
this
can
song
tell
is a
everybody.
Cover.
Okay.
So I only ever heard this song, like, the first time I heard it was through the cover. And then I went and looked it up, and I was like, oh, okay.
You are right to shake your head.
But we'll see how it goes.
Wow.
And also, it has three artists.
This is an exercise in
them.
Making everyone
okay,
listening
okay
feel
that,
old,
yeah.
Basically.
I don't even know.
No, I got this. Let's do
was
this.
Was this on tape?
Ready to redeem myself.
Yeah. Yes.
You know what? I like the place.
The work is no diggity.
She got
no
that one right away.
Yeah.
Artist is a tough one, though.
Blackstreet.
I mean, you and I know that, but...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yo, Trey dropped the verse.
And Trey.
It's Trey. It's Trey.
Dr. Dre.
All right.
AJ's dog. Dr. Dre.
Yeah.
All right. So she got that one.
Good.
Again, I'm just going to skip to the end.
Everything is about Pitch Perfect with you now.
Yeah. That's so.
Yeah. That's why they got it.
In charge of that one there.
Wow. So when you said famous cover, did you mean Pitch Perfect?
I did.
I knew.
Ew, that is not a famous cover. That is not a cover at all.
And Pitch Perfect was on cable.
Oh,
that's enough of
I'm
that.
I'm surprised they know what cable is.
All right. So,
damn kids.
So Meaghan
get off
yeah,
my
got
lawn.
Like four at best.
Get off my lawn.
Let's get off my lawn, kids. So then I picked three songs, and I asked Sarah, because she was going to be guessing them. I said, like, what's your wheelhouse? She said, you know, like 80s, I know pretty well. Anything in the 90s and beyond, yeah, throw it at me. So, of course, I'm like, all right. Gonna pick a couple pretty well-known 90s songs and then like a quirky 2000s one that like you either know or you don't because it had its time. So here was the first song that I picked for Sarah.
I'm in the hot seat, Meg's in the big girl chair.
Yes. So I've got Scott Lekter, gave me a list of songs to test Sarah on. And these are actually really good songs, so I'm not going to change anything.
Oh
like Sarah did to Jesse.
I'm like, that's the major shade to Jesse, but I mean...
Wow.
He shaded him,
not me.
He is the whole long weekend to...
They were good songs, I think.
They were good songs, man. Just nobody knew them.
No, these are songs that I think you have a chance of knowing, though, Sarah.
Okay.
So these
Thanks,
are good.
Scott.
Yeah, and
I
if
appreciate
you don't,
it.
It'll be
no problem, girls.
Soft. Yeah, you should know this. But okay,
okay.
All right, so first one.
And these are like
up here.
So right. obvious
okay,
to you and I.
Okay,
and
well, that's the thing, though.
All of our audience.
Give me a break.
Boulevard of Broken Dreams by
Green Day. No, wait.
It's Green Day.
No,
it's
no.
Green Day. Definitely Green Day.
Nirvana smells like Teen Spirit.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
Good.
Wow.
Billy Joe Armstrong is yelling at me.
I know he's roll. Well, he's not.
Billy Joe Armstrong just rolling in his grave.
A great song.
Great.
Good job.
Great record. Great record.
Okay, so that was number one. She got it. That was an embarrassing first guess, but.
Much.
Here was song number two.
Okay, ready? Song number two.
Again, you'll know it right off the first notes here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the one that I think you might not get. But give it a second.
Like, I feel like it picks up, and if it picks up, I might know
it
what it
does
is.
Not
but if it doesn't...
Well, drums come in at some point.
I will say that the lead-in, though, is, like, incredibly long. So you might have to give it a...
Okay.
Give it a good...
Because as of right now, I think it's one thing, but I know that's not it.
Well, what do you think it is?
Landslide by Alanis Morissette.
Wow.
Okay, so Landslide
is not by Alanis
Morissette. It's by Fleetwood Mac.
Okay, wait.
And then the Dixie Chicks do a cover of it.
Wow.
This
isn't.
Wait. Wait.
It's not. So
you're finding out today I am garbage. Sorry.
You're not garbage.
I promise
Look,
this
I
one gets even
me.
More
Does she do
worth
a cover
it by the end.
Though?
I don't know. If she does,
because
I'm not aware of it.
I think maybe I had a friend growing up. I should be listening to this.
Yeah. Okay, there we go. Oh, this is such a good song. I haven't heard this in forever.
It is a great song.
It's a great song. Which is why they should know what it is.
That's right.
Give me 1 second. I need to hear one of their voices again.
I need another one of their voices. It's in another minute. Jeez.
Yeah,
I mean, if you don't know it by now, you don't know it.
You don't know.
I have no idea.
I think we should.
The thing is that it takes really long to get to the chorus, so I don't know. I'll skip ahead.
Okay. I really don't think I've ever heard this before.
Oh, the generational divide is killing me.
Yeah.
What is it? She talks to angels by the Black Crows.
They're about to say, parents
dance. Hold on.
I've never even heard the Black Crows.
You know, like,
I know
Mr. Jones.
Yeah,
that's fine. Okay. Yeah, this is a very good song. It's a very good song. This is the one that I didn't know if you were going to get or not, but it's a good choice. It's a very good choice. Yeah.
So I corrected Meaghan after to let her know that the Black Crows and the Counting Crows are not the same band.
They used to be the same band. Okay. You know, throw all the shade you want about my tough music choices. Lekter gave you just layups, and you were like, yeah, Counting Crows are great.
I mean, windmill dunks, really.
Windmill dunks?
We're gonna throw it into a basketball metaphor.
So it wouldn't have mattered. Yeah, throw your shade on me all you want. It wouldn't have mattered what I gave them. They would have been like, I know this song. My parents danced to it as their first dance.
That's right.
In 1991. Because they're only 45 years old.
So here was my final track. Like I said, I wanted to pick something out of the 90s, something in the 2000s, something a little bit quirky where if you were there when it hit, you knew it.
Like
no
Apple
question.
Blossom by the White Stripes.
And I thought this might... Yeah, of course. And I thought this might be a bit before their time, but it's a standout song for its time. So okay. I just threw it in there. And this was the one I didn't expect them to get. Here it is, my third and final choice.
Great. This one you'll know. I don't know if you'll know the band. But,
you'll know.
You'll know it.
Oh my God.
I'm going to go yell at Scott.
She says,
you're a little iffy on Smells Like Teen Spirit.
And then Landslide by Alanis Morissette.
Stop. Oh
wow.
No.
Okay, well now you know. Now you know. I mean, an who absolute knows? Maybe train Alanis wreck has done around. Like a cover of it, like in a concert or something. Yeah. I don't know. I can't tell you. But I can't find one.
And
like,
again, this is
right
a song
now,
that
so.
Yeah. Okay, very first note.
Megan's always here to
you'll
fact
know,
check me.
Without question.
We have news.
Well, I mean, you're still beating me at this point.
This is more entertaining than the news.
Okay, I'm tired. So if you get this next one.
I'm at two.
You're at two.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, well,
again,
we're
generous.
Yeah, sorry. We're not tied at this point. No. But if you get this one,
then we'll be tied. And then what do we do in that instance?
We just live with the fact that we tied.
Okay.
I feel like
what is that?
Take it anyways.
No tiebreaker? No. Just live with it?
Come on. All right, here we go.
Can't live
God, these kids. Here we go.
Yeah. It's Stacey's Mom by Fountains of Wayne.
What? She just nails that. Yeah. Come on.
Right out of the gate.
Which is like a really
Fountains
crazy
of
thing
Wayne.
To say.
Yeah. I mean, because like, that's one of the most well-known riffs
like,
of all time.
The party's lulling. Someone just puts on this song and then everybody's instantaneously like party mode.
That
again.
Is absolutely
it's
true.
It's a funny song.
It is a funny
it's
song.
It's a song that's groovy, but is also, I think it's supposed to be funny. That's how I'm interpreting it.
I'm also.
Anyway, there's a little closing shade for Fountains of Wayne from from Brack. There you go,
Brack and Sibs.
Music trivia extraordinaire.
Pretty good. They sound good. And but I mean, yeah, throw all the shade you want about my music choices. Good Lord.
Oh, that was a lot of fun.
I know what this is. This is Green Day. Boulevard of Broken Dreams. No, sorry. Green Day, Wake Me Up When September Ends.
Oh, Billy Joe Armstrong, spinning in his grave.
I'm surprised they didn't say Billy Joel Armstrong.
Billy Joel Armstrong,
spinning in his grave.
The guitar man.
God, he's been dead for so long. That was hilarious.
Oh,
let's have them do that again.
Yes.
At some point.
Absolutely.
That was wonderful. You know what? Let's just have them do it on our show.
Yep.
Yep. And we'll do that again. But
Brack and Sibs.
But this is the thing. They asked for things that were tougher because
they
the first
did.
Ones were
yeah.
too easy.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I was like, all right, here's a couple of like lesser known tunes
right.
mixed in with possibly the greatest R&B rap duo song ever created in No Diggity by Blackstreet.
Well, now you get an idea as to where their wheelhouse is. So when we have them on the morning show to do another round of music trivia.
Yes.
You'll know where to go.
Yeah,
no future islands.
I'll go completely away from
get away from your hipster tunes.
The Mornings at the Cabin podcast was recorded before a sort of live, thankfully not in the studio, audience.
Wheeler and Lekter with you on your Thursday morning with a special guest, a friend of the show, friend of the cabin, volunteer radio host here at the cabin, and radio host extraordinaire, really. Jason Bose joins us. J-Bear to you lay people, right? but a couple of Sundays ago, longtime Yell Knifer Nancy McNeil posted a statement to Facebook calling for men to create a group where they can have uncomfortable conversations, hold one another accountable, and work to end misogynistic and violent behaviors, particularly in the arts community. You can find that story at cabinradio.ca, and that is what we are here to talk to J-Bear about. J-Bear has taken it upon himself to start a group with some help and some support and some obviously some suggestions from the community. And there is an event tonight called Answer the Call, basically answering the call that Nancy put out there for men in Yellowknife to speak to these issues and to hold men accountable for their behavior. And that's tonight at 8 at the Northern United Place. J-Bear, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Always happy to have you, man. And we always look forward to your show. Thank you for bringing us new music, because the rest of us don't know any. Ollie is stuck in the synths of the 80s. AJ doesn't listen to terrible music. We need that here at Cabin Radio. We need a balance. Okay. So obviously this is, this is a big deal. Nancy is a very well-respected person in the community, and when she talks, people listen. And she put up this letter and basically asking for men to hold themselves accountable in town. And now it was in response to a post that was from a few weeks before that, in which a friend of theirs and a friend in the city posted that they publicly outed their abuser. Let's just say it.
Yeah.
We haven't done a story on it. And it's one of those things that's kind of developing, but they publicly outed their abuser along with a list of asks that they hold themselves accountable, seek counseling, but also to leave town and the territory. And there was a lot of response to that, a lot of shares, and that kind of precipitated this call to action. Jay, you read the letter. Tell us about what your first reaction to that was.
Well, I think my first reaction was the same reaction that I often feel. It was this profound sense of guilt, if I'm being perfectly honest, because I've heard the call before. Where are the men? What are men doing?
Yeah.
And I think that there's this notion, and you see this in a lot of different ways in society today, that, well, it's just a few bad apples, just a few bad apples of this or just a few bad apples of that.
Mm-hmm.
Where are the good apples?
Yeah.
What are the people who are supposedly the good men or the good people or the good, you know, the positive example?
Yeah.
Why aren't they standing up and down shouting, I don't want to be characterized that way and I'm going to do something about it?
Yeah.
Or even beyond that, because that's a little bit of a defensive response.
Right.
Or saying, yes, there's a problem here, and as responsible people, we have an obligation to do something, particularly when it involves the safety of our community, the safety of women, the safety of our neighbors, our friends, our relatives, and just the human decency of not wanting someone to be violated in that way.
Yeah. And you're absolutely right. That's what people respond with. And it's the defensive response that you mentioned is like that. Not all men are like this. Yes. Not all men are like this. Great. Now show us how you can be, kind of thing, right?
Right.
So yeah, you're right. That's a defensive response, and it is something, and it's one of those responses that's going to happen with something like this. When he called out on your behavior, you're going to get defensive. I know I have a lot of work to do on that. When I get called out for crappy behavior that I do, I have a temper, and I will lose my temper sometimes, and I get called out on that from my partner, and you know, yeah, it makes you feel pretty defensive. It makes you feel pretty raw. When it's a broad call like this, and when it comes to, like, I think, okay, where do you actually, I'm just going to ask you straight up, where do you think that defensiveness comes from?
I think it comes from the fact that it's hard to deny that if you just accept that there are systems of patriarchy, that there are systems of toxic masculinity, and that there are systems that promote misogyny,
yep.
and that it's all around us. It's in our pop culture, it's in our organizations and structures. So we are born into that, and so we are all tainted by it in a way. And so we all have a role in that. And I think that when you are benefiting from these systems, and then it's called out that not only are some people not benefiting, but some people are actually being abused, and some people are actually being violated, and some people are actually having their dignity attacked. Mm. I think we all recognize a little part in ourselves that knows that we haven't done enough, and that for some of us that we know that we have been complicit, yeah, and complacent, and that it's just that feeling, you know, you know on some level that you're a part of this.
Yeah.
And that defensiveness, I think, you know, I also think that people want to think of themselves as good people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I think we kind of have to let go. I think this generation has been trying to tell us to let go of our binaries, you know. Yeah. It's not a matter of being good or bad. And the example I gave in a discussion the other day was that I asked a woman in the room whether she thought I was a good person, and she said yes. And I said, well, I can tell you, I know that that's true for her. That was yeah, her truth. I can tell you that there are some people who don't think I'm such a great person.
Yeah.
For a variety of different reasons.
Of course.
They're not wrong either.
Yeah.
I try and be a good person, but they're not wrong.
Yeah.
And the person who thinks I'm a good person isn't wrong. So, and I said that just to get rid of these notions of good person, bad,
yeah,
person.
Good, mm-hmm, good versus evil.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
We have work to do.
Yeah.
We have to look at ourselves, look at our place in this society, look at the ways we behave and the ways we respond, and unpack some of that stuff. And then after we've done that unpacking, think about, okay, what can we do to change the culture? What can we do to hold each other more accountable? Mm-hmm. What can we do to make this community safer?
Okay, absolutely. And so for this event tonight, what are you hoping for?
A lot of people, I think the other thing, you know, if we're speaking in generalities, and there's always some danger in that, but men are fixers and doers.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the feedback I've got is, let's start an organization. Let's
right,
build the structure of an organization. And I think we could get there.
Yeah.
But I don't want to do that tonight.
No, we got to start somewhere.
Tonight, I want, for the first little while, to get men talking about this issue to each other.
Mm.
I just don't think that happens a lot. I think it kind of happens in an extended way. Like, it's in pop, it's in the news, and it's in things like that. But I don't think a lot of men are having conversations with each other and hearing one another,
yeah,
and talking about, how did we get here? How did we get to a point where a woman in our community has to say, and I think it's tempting to think of it as a one-off, but I can tell you that Nancy was not writing that letter because of one incident.
No.
Mm-hmm. That is not why she wrote that letter. I've spoken to her. I can promise you that. So how did we get here that a woman had to write an open letter to the community to say, men, you're just not doing enough. You have a responsibility and an obligation, and you got to do something. I think we should all be a little bit embarrassed that it took that it took somebody else to tell us what we ought to be doing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How we're failing in our responsibilities to this community.
Yeah. And you're absolutely right. And that's what makes people uncomfortable, is that call to action. It makes you embarrassed. It makes you feel like, okay, I'm not doing enough. Or it makes you feel like, hey, I thought I was doing enough. I thought I'm a good person, blah, blah, blah. And you get very defensive about it. I mean, there's a lot of complex behavioral issues that go into this, that go into misogyny, that go into sexualized violence. These are learned behaviors for a lot of us. And then sometimes there's genetic factors that come into play. There's addiction factors that come into play. There are things like that. When it comes to not reconciling, but when it comes to the work that needs to be done by these men, including myself, including you, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
Counseling has to come deeply into play. So, I mean, one of the big hurdles here is that counseling is not readily available.
No.
And you have to wait months and months for appointment. Luckily, there are things like online counseling that you can do now. Like, you can actually interact with somebody and do some counseling. So there are some more avenues open. It's the matter of getting access to those things, because even having a group of like-minded individuals getting together and saying, this is a problem that we need to solve, we need to talk about it, may not necessarily do all the work that needs to be done, because you've said it before in a post that you're not an expert.
No. Nope.
You said it in the story actually this week, that you're not an expert. You're just here to try to facilitate and try to get something down on paper or create an infrastructure for moving forward. So I guess the question is, like, where do you want to go? You want to start now? Do you see a little bit like the next stop down the road? Or
I have to admit, like, one of the reasons why I haven't done this before, and I've thought about it before, but one of the reasons I haven't done it before is because of that whole thing. I basically felt I would get to the end of I would say, who am I to do this? Mm. Who am I to stand up in front of other people and say, this is what we need to do, be better, you know, any of that. So I'm trying to come at it from a place of humility, and I think you're absolutely on the money. There are some systemic things that need to be addressed. Mm-hmm. There's some political level things that need to be addressed. Yeah. Mental health is a big one. Huge. I think it is, like, there's all kinds of intersectional pieces of this.
Yeah.
So I think that's one of the things that we might be heading towards down the road with this group, is that we might think of, about some lobbying and some and some demands that the government look at what services it has available and the impact of the lack of services, and do some lobbying on that part. I think that's one. I think that's something. If somebody is sitting at home and is like, I can't come to the meeting and there's not much I can do, write letters about it.
Yeah,
You could do that. I mean, and that's one of the things we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about what are things that we as individuals have the power to do, to be able to at least say we're trying.
Right.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I mean, that's what this is about.
Yeah.
This is about, like, exactly this, answering the call. We've been, you know, the gauntlet's been thrown. What are we going to do about it?
Yep.
And you're taking it upon yourself to organize this, which is, I can read it on you, right?
Yep.
This is a tough thing, very tough thing for you to do. And I mean, it's work that's been done by women and femme people for a very long time. And men and masculine folks are starting to take over, move the yardstick a little bit as well.
Mm.
But I mean, here in Yellowknife, this is one thing that hasn't really, not publicly, kind of come out yet. So I mean, kudos for doing it. But obviously, there's a ton of work to be done.
Yeah, and just want to mention just quickly, I wanted to make sure I got out tonight at Northern United Place. Because of COVID, there is a maximum capacity of 25 people.
Mm-hmm.
So myself and 24 other people. I'm worried that will mean some people will need to be turned away. I will try and have some sort of resources available for them after the meeting. And just want to apologize up front that some people might have to be turned away. I've also been asked the question of, are women allowed to come? I hate the notion of turning anyone away who wants to come and help.
Yeah.
I do want to make it clear, though, that the focus of this meeting is to get men to do the work. And so the conversations are going to be about what men can do, how we can support each other, and what we need to do as individuals. So that's going to be the focus of the topic. If women feel like they have something to add to that conversation and ways to support that conversation, then by all means, they're welcome to come.
Okay. Thanks so much, Ben. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. This is obviously a very important meeting coming up tonight. And, like, I mean, I think people are going to understand that they may be turned away. Maybe what we could do is, like, have a list outside. If you're turned away, give us your email, and we'll send you the notes to the meeting or whatever. Like,
absolutely.
You can do that kind of thing. Okay, so that's tonight at Northern United Place from 8 till 9:30, or kind of whenever it ends, pretty much. If you can make it down there, please do. If you feel like you have some questions, ask
media them. Was that a thing you wanted to?
Yeah, I had some questions about the media. Yeah. I would ask that, you know, if you're a member of the media and you just want to come on your own as an individual to participate, by all means. But you know, this is a very sensitive topic, and so people are going to get into some very personal things. And so I think it's fair that they be able to say those things without having to worry about will it be printed in the media or will it be covered in the media. I will make myself available for interviews after the event, if that's wanted or needed.
Okay. Thanks so much, man. I appreciate it.
Thanks for taking this on, Jay.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Answer the Call tonight at Northern United Place from 8 o'clock. You can find Answer the Call on Facebook if you want more information about the event. I guess, actually, one more question, Jay, before we go. Will you be kind of making yourself open to inquiry, suggestions, things like that? Do you have an email maybe that people want to get in touch with you at?
Right now, I would have them go through the event page.
Okay.
And but also, I'm on Facebook, and if you want to shoot me a private message, that's fine, too.
Okay, perfect, man. Thanks so much. That's tonight, Northern United Place. Get on down there if you can, and if you are turned away, I think we'll be able to get in. You'll be able to get in touch with Jay or anyone else who's going to be part of this organizational team a little later on.
The Mornings at the Cabin podcast.
You watched that Raptors game last night? You watched a bit of it?
I watched the second overtime.
Crazy.
That was nuts.
Crazy game. It's already being called. It's being called one of the greatest Raptors games of all time.
Yeah.
One of the best playoff games of all time.
Oh, like, man.
players from all over the league chiming in going, this is an instant classic. And yeah. It was, absolutely.
Oh, God, yeah.
Very fun to watch. And they forced Game 7 in their semifinal. They went to seven games in the semifinal last year in the conference semifinal against the Philadelphia 76ers. And mm-hmm. we all know how that ended
yes.
with Kawhi and the shot. So we look forward to that tomorrow night. Friday for Game 7.
We're going to get together for that?
Semifinal? Maybe.
Watch a little Raptors basketball?
I don't know. It's always tough watching Game 7s because remember the last time we watched a Game 7 together?
It was, well, we can't watch it with Mike. We know he's out. He's got to watch it alone.
But it was Toronto and Boston. Yeah. And it was a couple years ago. It wasn't the major collapse, but like they came back. They clawed back to answer that to force Game 7. I came over to your place to watch it, and it wasn't that fun.
Oh, the Leafs Bruins. Sorry, yeah. I thought you were still talking basketball.
No, Leafs Bruins.
I don't remember basketball before last
that's
year.
That's right. There was basketball before last year.
I think that was the Raptors' inaugural season, as far as I recall. that's too personal.
It's right.
Yeah, I didn't even want you over there. You just came over.
That's true. I do just show up every now and again. The other thing I wanted to touch on, I saw this. It was a silly post. I didn't want to do a full break on it, but there was a post about taking your shoes on or leaving your shoes on or taking them off when you come to somebody's house. Now, in America, like you see it on TV, but in America, apparently leaving your shoes on in somebody's house is like common. Yeah. But in Canada, it's more of like a take your shoes off.
Yeah,
so the question was, do you take your shoes off when you go to somebody's house? And like some people were like, well, it depends on what they ask and blah, blah, blah. And most people were like, no, what are you, an animal? Take your shoes off.
Yeah. You take your shoes off unless they say as you walk through the door, don't bother taking your shoes off.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you're like helping them move or something.
Yeah, helping them move.
Yeah.
Or they've got a cement floor. Like you guys have a cement floor, right?
It's like tile.
Yes, a tile. Cement. Yeah. Whatever. But I mean, it's not carpet.
We don't live in a basement, Jesse.
You live in a basement. You live in a sub-basement with a concrete floor.
Unfinished.
It's soundproof. It's place is creepy.
No drywall.
But so I mean, like in a place like that, I mean, it would make a bit more sense to, you know, for someone to allow you to leave your shoes on. But I think it's a very Canadian thing that you take your shoes off.
Well, yeah,
it's gross.
I know what you walked through.
Exactly, and that's exactly what I said in the comment. It's like, yeah, take your shoes off and leave them at the door. You know how much disgusting crap you walk through? Like literal, you might walk through crap.
Who's arguing for shoes on?
Oh, just people on the internet.
American people?
No, Canadian people.
Canadian people.
This is on, I wasn't going to say it, but it was on a competing radio station's Facebook.
In Windsor?
No, it was in Calgary.
Calgary?
We're competing with CJ92.
What?
And people, it was going back and forth. Most people were like, they're Canadian and basically saying, I think in Canada it's just a custom that you take your shoes off.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But in America, not so much.
No.
You see it on TV shows. It's the weirdest thing. We were watching Modern Family a couple weeks ago, which we've now stopped watching because it's annoying. But everybody's wearing...
It's annoying.
Well, it's so repetitive. Like, we got to season 5, and we're just like, all right.
I mean, it's been the same show for 15 years.
I don't care about the further adventures of the family. But everybody wears shoes inside. And so, like, you're sitting on the couch, walking on carpet with shoes on. And it's like, well... Like you're not Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. You're not putting on a new pair of shoes. That's where it comes from, probably.
Mm.
Right? Because he would take off his outdoor shoes...
Right.
And then he put on his inside shoes.
Up here, we have
weirdo
slippers.
Yeah, up here we have slippers or sock feet.
That's right.
Yeah, so, I mean, I'm not going to put
or
this
just
out
bare
there.
Feet.
Yeah, just bare feet.
How do you feel? Oh, here's a question. How do you feel about going over to someone's house or a visitor coming in and just walking around with bare feet? Is that gross?
Well, I mean, again, depends on what, like, I mean, if they're wearing Birkies or whatever, that's kind of what they have to do, right? Walking around
with
bare feet.
A lot of people wear socks with Birkies.
I know. My dad was one of them. He kind of popularized the look. So I don't know. I mean, like, I wear Birkin. I'm wearing them right now.
Yeah.
So I know that some people find them disgusting, especially on men, because men's feet are so gross. It's like, well, all feet are kind of gross.
Your feet are quite nice.
They're not, but honestly. Thank you. So
it looks like you got a pedicure.
I did not get a pedicure.
No?
All right. If anything, I do my own pedicure, and I mess it up. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, walking around in bare feet, again, like, if you got some shoes on or whatever, then I guess it's fine.
I think it's a little...
It's a little gross? So, should I bring over, like, those temporary socks that you get at shoe stores?
Oh,
to your house?
There you go.
Slap those on?
Yeah.
Just, like, reuse pantyhose and they're cut into sock shape?
Those seem like a health hazard. Those seem like you would just take your first step and your foot would just fly out from under you.
That's exactly
right.
That's
I don't
exactly
know how slippery they are, but...
Well, I don't wear them.
I'm a little... you know, I
put
don't know. It's weird. I don't know if I can put it into, like a concrete context
floor.
Type situation. Concrete
your
floor.
Sub-basement
who would wear bare feet on a concrete floor?
Well, I mean, if you had in-floor heating.
Oh, that's fair.
Better grip.
Yeah,
better grip
on the concrete. Take your shoes off.
Yeah.
With that we can all agree
okay,
on.
Great. I didn't think we were going to get into an argument about this, but it did turn into a real break. So wear shoes, I guess. It's weird.
No,
I think it's weird.
Take your shoes off.
I mean, sorry. That's what I mean. Take shoes off.
You're getting me all argumentative.
Take your shoes off and you go into somebody's house. There it is.
I think that's
controversial statement.
Pretty cut and dry.
Don't drag dog poop into my house. All right. That's going to do it for Mornings at the Cabin. Please, if you're a dude listening to this or a masculine person, head on down to answer the call at NUP tonight. If you get turned away, send in your information. There's going to be some great talks tonight, I imagine. And maybe the start of something very concrete here in the city. So go check that out. Talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening. Check out more from the show at cabinradio.ca and by following the Mornings at the Cabin Facebook page.